Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Jerry Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McElrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Tal Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Diala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferranjit.
And I choose OGIO.
All new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Everyone, welcome to the SML Show presented by Yamaha Motors and OGIO Powersports. Today I've got Nathan Ramsey, the Rockstar Energy Husqvarna team manager, in the hot seat. But more than that, I mean, dude, I think, wow, we're dating ourselves here. But we've been buddies for well over 20 years, 25 or so.
Yeah.
When the you're on Pro Circuit, Mitch Payton's team, you got the title in 99, West Coast.
Yep.
But you did a lot after that, but
thanks. It has been a while. We're dating ourselves, but we're getting there, so we got to own it, you know, at this point.
Yeah, you're going to turn 49 pretty soon?
Just turned 49.
I'll be 55, dude. Yeah. I was telling my kids, I'm like, oh, dude, 55. You know that Sammy Hagar song? Like, I was telling about it. My kids, all, who's Sammy Hagar?
Yeah, right. But, they don't get that. But it could be worse.
You know? Is it crazy to you to think that, you know, you're still making a living in the motocross industry? Like, is that what your goal was, to stay in motocross after retiring?
I think the whole time I always kind of imagined myself getting into some sort of role like this.
Yeah.
But growing up, I mean, I didn't even think I was going to be a professional racer, you know, let alone be part of the industry for, you know, 30 plus years or whatever it ends up being in the end. But yeah, I mean, it's at one point, you know, I did manage another team, that JDR J-Star team. Mm-hmm. And I guess to back up a little bit, I always thought it'd be really cool, you know, to be a team manager when I'm done. I think that'd be like the next cool step. And then I got in that role, and it was great, and it was a fun learning experience. But I thought I knew what team managers did, you know, but I really only knew the interaction with the rider.
Yeah.
So there was a whole lot to learn, and I think I started the first year, and I wasn't overly worried or anxious about anything because I didn't know what to be worried about. So as the years went on, it's almost like you know more, so you kind of worry about things being in place, and
you realize
it got kind of worse.
Yeah. Was that like early on that with that team when Malcolm was on the team? It was Skull Candy and all that.
Yep. I'm gonna test my memory. I knew this would happen. So at first, you know, when it's Jay and Derek Reinenberg were the owners, which is the JDR and Australian family that kind of put it all together. When they first came over, it was, you know, PJ Larson, Ty Simmons, who else was there? They eventually brought over like Josh Kasia and stuff. So it was kind of already set, the riders, when they came at first.
Yeah.
So I just sort of, you know, jumped in and just started doing my thing, but didn't really have a part in picking the riders. So it wasn't until 2012, I think.
Is that like Mookie Malcolm and Savachi?
Yep. Malcolm and Joey. And I mean, I went to Loretta's to kind of watch and see if we wanted to maybe do something with Joey, and watched him and kind of put the deal together and got it going. So that was kind of the first point where I got to, you know, have my two cents put in on it. But they did a good job with what they, you know, what they started us out with. And you know, I was happy to work with PJ and Ty. And Ty was really cool, laid back, old soul guy who probably came a year or two too early. But it's really hard to read, you know, like you're over there, you're doing really good. you know, he was basically next thing coming out of Australia, and you know, he just came over here, and it was tough. And he was also, you know, early days of the 350, but he was a bigger guy, so mm-hmm. a couple things working against him. But it was good. It was fun working with those guys, and then just trying to build from there. And I think we had a good thing going, but ultimately, just didn't work out. Mm-hmm. Learned a lot.
We're gonna hit the rewind button a little. Right.
Okay. 99,
125 West Coast Supercross champ, Mitch Payton's Pro Circuit Kawasaki team, KX125. Mm-hmm. I just remember Thor gear, Shoei helmet, Scott goggles with that crazy red lens that you used to always wear.
Yeah, it was peach, actually. Peach. Yeah, peach. It was the amber lens. But yeah, I wore that indoors, outdoors, everywhere, all the time.
Yeah, I remember told me I could see better at night with it.
Yeah, it just kind of made everything the same color all the time. Mm-hmm. So some of the other lenses would brighten it up, but then it was different when maybe shadows or, you know, under the stadium lights. So yeah, I wore it night races, day races, everything.
Full time.
And so it didn't go brighter in the sunlight. It just stayed the same. So
yeah.
It was real consistent. So I liked it. I still like it to this day, or at mm-hmm. least a version of that, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Two strokes are, you know, cool now, right? Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's funny to think that you raced a 125 in Supercross, and like I remember interviewing Mitch or hanging out with him once, and he said this was after 125s had been replaced by 250s, but he's like, oh, we kind of tuned the bike for the triple jump, you know, mm-hmm. like if we knew we could make the triple every lap, we were dialed.
Yeah,
but, I mean, do you remember that kind of mentality?
Oh yes, definitely. I mean, I can remember shifting right at the base, you know, from second to third, because depending on how you set your bike up, you jump it in second, or you most of the 125s back then, you had to get to third. Mm-hmm. And it was always a little scary shifting at the base of the jump. One time at the test track, I was, you know, testing, doing my thing, and it got kind of bumpy up to the lead up, you know, acceleration bumps for the triple. And when I went to click the third, I shifted it, and it was like a brand new bike that I was breaking in and doing testing on, and literally big huge crash, you know. Oh. Didn't make, because I went to fourth,
yeah,
and it just I think they literally just used that bike for parts after that. I bent everything on it, you know, so that was painful. And I think the technicality of the 125 days was tough. So when you look back at it, you know, people over the years, like, you know, I did the amateur thing for so long, and a lot of those kids didn't even know who I was, or if they knew who I was, mm-hmm. they didn't watch me race. And sometimes they'd watch one, and you know, older race, and I'm like, just like, it's not as pretty as it is these days, because the 125, I mean, you had to hit the corner in the correct gear every time. You had to hit your shift every time. So if the corner poked out and you lost a little bit of your speed or momentum, or you buried it, like, it was really technical and hard, so you had to get it right to make the jumps.
Mm-hmm. Crazy, huh? Mm-hmm. And then that year, the KX, the perimeter, steel perimeter frame, mm-hmm. like I know in outdoors, they flexed a lot, right? The frame would expire because it gets stretched
it would
out.
Stretch. Yeah.
Did you ever like pull the cylinder off the studs?
You know, I don't remember. I feel like that it probably happened because I was, you know, not crazy rough on equipment, but I, you know, I rode pretty hard, and I didn't always make it all the way over the jumps or time it perfect.
Yeah.
So I'm sure that happened. I remember being a part of it, but I just don't remember it completely pulling out on me, like or at least in a crucial situation where it really stuck in my head.
Yeah. I just remember spending some time at Ricky's house at the farm, mm-hmm. and I think over the 3 days I was there, he did it to two of his bikes. I just remember seeing steam everywhere.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that flex was part of what made it handle good too at the same time. But you're right, there was a expiration hour marker on that thing. So
it's crazy. It's crazy good how our sport has come along and changed.
Yeah, it is. Even looking back on the old stuff and watching the speeds and everything that, you know, guys previous to me or prior to me, and then myself, just looking at the speeds, it's just not the same. You know, we mm-hmm. watch now and it's like, you can get the job done as quick as you want to these days, you know?
Yeah.
250 or 450.
Yeah. Hey, Nate, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for more. Hey everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Okay, so Nate, it's funny because the thing that stands out is, like I told you, KX125, Thor Gear Show. I did a little research. I'm like, wow, okay, yeah, I remember he rode for that team and this. But instead of spending the whole segment going through this year, it went here, there. Mm-hmm. Let's just name him real quick. So he went from Mitch's team. Did you go to Honda after that?
No, or Yamaha of Troy.
Yamaha of Troy, yep. YOT.
Mm-hmm. 1 year there, yeah.
Yeah, YOT. And then you gave the YZ250F its competition debut in the U.S.
Correct, right? Yep.
Because Ernesto, I went to Japan with Ernesto, and he raced it in the Japan Nationals.
Yep.
So I remember he raced it first, but.
Yep.
So YOT, and then you went to Honda.
Yep. 3 years there.
3 years. Were you on the 450 initially?
Yep.
And then the 250 towards the end, right? Mm-hmm. So you gave both the four-stroke Hondas their competition debuts.
Yeah. So just to not slow you down too much, but when I made the decision to leave Pro Circuit and go to Yamaha of Troy, it was based around the
four-stroke.
I was getting information. You know, Bob Moore was my agent at the time, and he was telling me, you know, the whole sport's going to be four-stroke, and I was like, it was hard to believe.
Yeah.
But I was a little bit older. You know, I started racing later than most, so I was a little bit older, so I felt like I needed a little bit of an edge to try to get ahead of the curve. And so I based that decision on being able to debut the Yamaha, you know, or be a part of that. And I mean, that just kept leading to more debuts. So yeah, the 450.
Yeah, and then you're the first victory on the 450 Honda too.
Yep.
Right, and Ricky was on a two-stroke still?
Yep.
That was a crazy night for you.
Oh, it was, yes. That one isn't super hard for me to remember. That one sticks in my head really good. Just, you know, seeing what happened to Ricky after he looped out off the dragon back, and you know, it was almost like everybody in the class all of a sudden their eyes got like huge. Like, all right, this is our chance, right? So as you probably know, there's tons of leaders. I think 6 or 8 leaders, I think, throughout the whole thing. And I guess the most vivid part of it was I took the white flag and I was in the lead. I was still in the lead at that moment after seeing everything unfold. And then when I hit the white flag, I'm like, oh, this can really happen. Like, and then I was like, I ain't letting nobody pass me this final lap. And I could hear the crowd because they were super into it, because Ricky obviously had an amazing ride coming back, you know, back through the pack. And it felt like he was breathing down my neck. And so I was like, every insight I could take, I was just like,
yeah,
he might be faster, but he's going to have to figure out a crazy way to get around me. So, once I took that, the white flag, I'm like, I'm still leading this thing. I'm not giving it up. So it was really super cool. And I've said before in other interviews, probably one of the coolest moments of my career is, you know, taking that win, checker flag, and then rolling on the next jump. And I got Ricky on one side of me and McGrath on the other side of me congratulating me. And it really, truly felt like they were genuinely happy for me. And I'm just like going, can't believe this. Yeah, awesome. Awesome moment.
What I remember about that year is we shot a cover for Transworld Motocross. You were wearing Axo gear.
Yep.
Was it an HJC helmet?
Yes.
Yeah. And we were at, remember, Competition Park? That's where we did it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I just remember how dusty and crappy it was, but you were doing berm blowouts. And
yeah. So I don't know if you're going there with this story, but you may not even remember, but if you take a good look at the picture, you'll probably remember. So we were hitting, they would water because it was so powdery.
Yeah.
They would water and then I would hit it, you know, water and hit it. And so I fell. So the whole, and that's the only gear I had that day. Yeah. So this side of mine is muddy. So we ended up having to go left-handers. And if you look in the picture, you can see like mud up
on my mud.
Yeah. Kind of funny. We had to switch it up because I fell over.
Yeah. That's crazy too, because that was back in the slide film days, right?
Yeah.
So we didn't know if we caught it or not.
You know,
it's not like digital. And
yeah.
Everything has changed, huh, in the world.
It's crazy. Crazy.
Okay. So from there, you went to KTM?
Yep.
And that was to debut the 250 SXF, right?
So just during the Honda days, I broke my femur going into the 03 season, I believe. So I went, 02, 03, and so, no, I was going into, no, yeah, 03. I broke my femur in November, right before, you know, feeling great, you know, ready to get Supercross started. Broke my femur, and just that year was pretty terrible. I came back, but, you know, I really wasn't even back to ground zero for like a year. Mm-hmm. Just, I mean, up to speed and things like that, you know. So Honda reached out to me and, you know, asked me if I would consider, I never pointed out, so consider, you know, going back to the, what was called the lights class back then. And they wanted me to debut their 250F. So I did the Yamaha, the Honda 450, and now the Honda 250. Uh-huh. So I became kind of this guy that was willing to probably be the guinea pig a little bit. It helped my career. I did a lot of testing, and most days I was pretty good at feeling the bike. And so then that debut then led to the KTM 250F.
Mm-hmm. Did that bike have a linkage?
No.
Okay, talk about, of all the bikes you debuted, right? You had this chance to be a test rider and mm-hmm. give bikes debuts. Which one was the best and which one was the toughest to work with?
So there was things I liked about all of them. I think probably, it's funny because I the Yamaha had some issues with, you know, it started out with oil in the frame, you know, and then we figured out how to not have to do that. So there was a lot of little changes. And to be honest, Ernesto had more problems that year with his bike than me. So it was, everything was so new. I think the hardest thing about that one was just starting it, you know. Well, they were all hard to start, but the Yamaha was the hardest at the time.
Yeah.
And then transitioning over to the Honda. So I did the Honda 450 and it was a rocket ship. I mean, they sent over from Japan with like pretty much all their specs that they came up with. Fastest bike I've still ever ridden. And I mean, it was so fast. I had to get like Eric Kehoe, team manager at the time. I'm like, you have to ride this so you know what I'm talking about. So we spent like 2 years trying to slow it down.
Yeah.
I knocked two of my teeth out. I thought I had it rideable and got to Anaheim. And I mean, I crashed like four times in practice, like, because I was obviously excited and, you know, amped up for the day. And then, you know, that bike and me being a little nutty wasn't a good combo. So, I crashed, knocked two of my front teeth out, which they're fake anyway. So it's not the same as someone with their own teeth. I crashed and did the rest of the night with no teeth. And back to answering your question. So the 450 was pretty solid, besides it was too fast and hard to hang on to. Mm-hmm. And I have a story behind that hard to hang on to with the 450 we can come back to. But then the Honda 250 was awesome in like a lot of ways. Most ways, but it cut out. Like it would just cut out on jump faces or in transitions just out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. So I spent that whole year basically jumping just like this. So I was a lot like this, because if it cut out, then it would put me on the right trajectory. So I had to adapt. And it's weird because thinking back on it, I never got all spun out like I'm being a guinea pig. What if, you know, what if? Mm-hmm. I was happy to have a deal and be a factory rider and doing what I love to do. So I just thought that was just par for the course, you know, part of that. So I would probably say, this, even though it wasn't the worst bike, the scariest was the Honda 250. Debuting that, just because there was just some weird stuff going on where it would cut out just kind of out of nowhere. And then best, you're saying 250F or four stroke. It's a tough one. I mean, like I said, there's pros and cons to all of them, but probably the Honda 450. You know, I mean, we got it into a point where it became close to rideable. At least I figured it out a little bit. And I always felt like, you know, I came from Pro Circuit and they just, you know, they did so much testing. I mean, every piece, and like whether it showed good or bad on the dyno, it was just constant testing. And Honda was similar to that. You know, they had access to some other stuff, obviously. And so they were similar, but you know, some of the teams that I was on either they didn't have the all that stuff to test, or they felt like, which I know now, you can spin somebody out really easy with too many options, mm-hmm. right? So then they potentially limited the options and you know, kept it in one wheelhouse to where it was you. I didn't try as many things. So mm-hmm. between Pro Circuit and Honda is really probably what developed me into kind of being good at testing the motorcycle.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool. One more quick break to hear from our sponsors and we're back for more. Guys, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. All right, so we covered all the racing, or you know, most of it. We don't need to go through the JGR and L&M stuff, but going back, okay, so we know that there's a rapper named Nate Dogg, mm-hmm. but your nickname has always been Nate Dogg, so you knew I was going to ask you to show us why.
Oh, man, because I can bark.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Put me on the spot, huh?
Yeah. I should have brought my dog in.
Yeah.
You scared the shit
freaking
out of me.
Out. I used to do a big dog, little dog fight because I stayed with Red Dog in Florida and out here in California at one point. And we'd be across the house and then like laying in bed going to sleep at night. And he'd be, do the big dog, little dog fight. So it'd be like, you know. So, yeah, but I had Nate Dogg pretty far before that, but it was because I could bark.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay, current team manager of the Rockstar Energy Husqvarna team. 2002, I think, was your first year, right?
22, yeah. 22.
Yeah, or 2022, duh.
Yeah. Ooh, I have some experience.
See how we
now.
Are. But role opened up, was offered to you, and you're just like, heck yeah. I mean, or was there pros and cons to it? Like,
yeah, for sure. I had been doing the amateur stuff for KTM.
Mm-hmm.
I started, Christy LeCurl was the team manager of the amateur racing, and it was just KTM at that time. She brought me in as a coach. I coached at, I think I did the camp first. I think, yeah, she brought me in for a camp before Loretta's, and I did Loretta's, and then that kind of evolved into what they called performance manager, which I kept coaching the riders and working with all the riders. But at the same time, started working with sponsors and, you know, just kind of absorbing more of things like that as what a manager would do. And I guess to back that up, you know, when Michael Sleater stepped away is when Christy became manager, mm-hmm. and she, you know, she felt there was a void because Sleater was so good with the riders and could help them with line selections. And she's like, I can't do that. They, mm-hmm. even if I knew, they don't want to hear it from me, you know? So, that kind of got me into that. I did that for almost 9 years as the amateur. So, and it evolved, right? So then they, you know, Husky got added into it and then ultimately, Gas. So in the end, you know, and now it's Daniel Blair who's in that position, but you got three brands to deal with, and it becomes a lot of moving small parts in yeah. the, you know, and everything's huge on the amateur level and that, you know, in that role. So, yeah, I did that. So, and I, you know, obviously I felt comfortable with pro racing. To be honest, I was way more comfortable with that. I raced as, you know, as a racer for 16 years as a professional racer. And then I did the JDR thing, for 3 years, and then went into the amateur racing. So I was actually a little overwhelmed by amateur racing when I first got in there.
So many
classes and so many kids. I mean, you go to, you know, when they go to Loretta's, they can only do two classes each. Mm-hmm. So that's the easy one, you know. When you go to like Freestone or Mini O's or whatever, some of these kids would do five classes.
Yeah.
And then think about that, five classes or four classes. I'd say the average is 3 to 4. After I learned, I would tell them don't do more than 3 because it would just become they're just beat up and tired the whole mm-hmm. time. But imagine, you know, 4 class average and, you know, these guys, there's 18, 19 riders on the team and they're all healthy and they're there. And it's like, whew. I mean, I didn't even have time to go grab a water or anything.
Yeah.
Because I was always wanting to be there for them at the beginning of the race, you know, and try to, if there was anything I saw, or just make sure they were in the right headspace and help them choose their gate. So spent a lot of time, you know, starting line. And then if I had a minute, I would go to the finish line and meet them over there. And luckily, KTM also had a setup where there was like a social media person. And they would be at the finish line if I couldn't make it, you know. So yeah. it was a good little setup. And then ultimately there was a little bit of buzz around, okay, you know, Scuba may be leaving the Rockstar Husky team. And, you know, would you ever consider it, you know? I can't remember if Hines called me and asked me that, or maybe it was probably Roger. And there's a little buzz around, and I was like, yeah, I would. I mean, I'm happy where I'm at, and I enjoy this, and I feel like I was pretty well-rounded at that point because I had learned a lot about the amateur racing. And they asked me, and then it just sort of, I didn't hear any more about it. So, and I wasn't asking or trying to push it or make it happen. And it was about 2 months went by, and then I was on a team's budget meeting, going over the budget, and I shared an office with TK. Like, so we were kind of just opposite sides, but and Ian came and, you know, knocked at the door, and I'm like, oh, I'm on a budget meeting, you know. And then he came back like 2 or 3 minutes later, and TK's like, I think you probably should get off your meeting and go to see what he wants, you know, because I mean that's who I answered to at KTM still to this day. So I'm like, oh yeah, you're probably right. It seems pretty important. So, you know, hey Nina, sorry, I need to jump off of here, and we were pretty close to being done anyway. So try and fast forward. So I go walking with Ian, and he kind of walks me to the back of the old building now, and I walk into this room, and it's Roger, Ian, Pitt, Robert Jonas, they're all sitting at this round table, and they're like, here, sit down. And they all kind of had this grim look on their face, and I'm like, okay. So I sit down and just sort of looking around, and Robert Jonas says, you're done with amateur racing.
Nice.
And he just kind of sat there like quiet.
Just told you.
And I'm like, okay, like, what does that mean? You know, because I didn't really think I was fired, you know, or anything like that, because I really hadn't had anything weird happen to, you know, initiate that. But, and then he was like, we need you over at Rockstar Husky. And I was like, okay. So that happened. I'll probably get the days wrong, but it's quick, right? So they pulled me into that room. So meanwhile, 2 months ago, I heard, oh, would you ever be interested? And I was kind of like, yeah, but I think this structure needs to be in place or it's a lose situation. Because Scuba was in there, and Scuba was team manager and crew chief. And I'm like, I would be interested if you could put the right people in place. You know, we need a crew chief. We need, you know, a team manager. And then what I believe is leadership crew is, you know, the team manager, crew chief, and the coordinator. Because that's what it takes to kind of lead one of these teams and have some good people, you know, mm-hmm. bouncing ideas and, you know, thoughts and things back and forth. So that was 2 months. Then I'm sitting in this room, and literally the next morning, I roll in, and they introduce me to the team. They walk me right into the Husky shop, and it was, it was me and Tony Hall, who was the off-road crew chief of all brands over mm-hmm. there. And I didn't know Tony. I mean, I seen him in passing, and, you know, hi. Barely said hi to each other, you know, just because we just lived in such different worlds. Yeah. And me, Sean, and Tony, Sean Murphy, walked us in there and just announced us as the new, you know, leadership of the team. And mm-hmm. everyone knew Scuba was leaving, and he chose to leave on his own accord, so it wasn't anything weird like that. So there's no ill will. But now, looking back and things I know now, there was people who thought, okay, well, I should, if Scuba's leaving, I'll probably go here, you know, I'll go here. It was, so I didn't realize how maybe tough it was going to be. They all knew me, and mm-hmm. I think there was never anybody that just didn't like me, you know, but there was people who thought it went down. Mm-hmm. Not the way that they thought it should. So, introduced us, I had to say a few things, and then, So I think that was Wednesday. So must have pulled me in the office Tuesday. Wednesday morning, I'm in there. They announce me, and then I went into my office. Like, it was like announced. We did a few more things, and then here's your shirt. Here's your this. Let's take a picture. And yeah. This was right before Anaheim 2. So they had done the first two rounds.
Yeah.
Or maybe the first three rounds, actually, because they went. They went up to, I think it was Oakland for the second round or something. Anyway, so, yeah. So, I went, so Tuesday, pulled me in the office, tell me. Wednesday, I mean, I could have said no, but yeah. I just was like, okay, if this is what you guys think I should be doing, I'm game. Let's go.
Yeah.
Tuesday, pulled me in the office. Wednesday, introduced. Friday, I'm at Anaheim, too. As the team manager of the team. Like, I mean, it happened so fast and my head was like spinning off, mm-hmm, you know? Mm-hmm. So it was, and Tony was in the same position. Sean had been there, and he is very well respected with the team, and he's really the glue that kind of kept them from being a little bit, you know, put off by the situation and the way it went down. And, you know, and he was caught in the middle of it, but man, he's such a good guy and so professional, and he just wants to work hard and win races, you know? So mm-hmm. He really kind of bridged the gap that we needed to kind of put it all together. So ultimately, yeah, we wind up at Anaheim 2. And from that point, I'm week in, week out. And it's kind of baby steps at first for myself and also Tony as the crew chief. You know, yeah. I didn't want to come in there and just start saying, we need to do this, we need to do that. I needed to learn everyone, you know, try to get a little bit of respect from them, mm-hmm. And ultimately show them that I was willing to do what it takes. And, you know, I think that was my approach and philosophy, is just to show them that I'll do whatever it takes. Yeah. No job too big, no job too small, and let's all work together. And that was the whole thing, just trying to get everybody pointed in the same direction. So it was tough. There was some very tough times, and ultimately I think it was just, it was time. It needed time and people to process. Mm-hmm. And I enjoyed it though. Like I kind of explained to people, like I love the amateur part of it. And like I mentioned earlier, everything was a big deal in the amateur world, but it's the same thing as being an amateur racer, you know, as being an amateur team manager. It's a big deal, but I always knew the big picture. So I'm like, these parents and these kids were panicking and freaking out about a bad lap time or a bad moto at some race that they work so hard, and they pour themselves into it. So you want the best for them, and you feel for them when it doesn't work out. And we all know the sport is full of that. And then switching into manager of the pro team is the sort of the same pressures as being a pro racer. You know, you have to perform as a team on an elite level. Like, mm-hmm. It's a factory team. And it was the first time I've been involved with the factory team on a pro level. I had a satellite team that had factory support, which was cool, and I learned a lot. But without learning the corporate side of things with the amateur racing, that whole step into the factory situation would have been really tough for me.
Yeah.
So it was pretty eye-opening. And like I said, everyone was supportive. Roger, Ian, Robert Jonas, like they tried to help as much, so it wasn't as hard. But again, between me and Tony and Sean, we just started developing this, you know, you're good at that, I'm good at this. So mm-hmm. like let's just try to, instead of me trying to do what you do or vice versa, let's work together. And they just open-minded like that. So it was nice. And now it's just kind of kept getting better and better, and the pieces just keep complimenting each other. And I think it's running really good. I think that at this point, like I said it this weekend, I think I said it today earlier, and I'm just like, I'm so happy, and I feel lucky and fortunate that we have such a good crew. Mm-hmm. I mean, with the ups and downs with racing with any team, but I can speak for our team because, you know, we've had some rough stuff. Malcolm, you know, looked amazing for the first two rounds, and then he blew his knee out. Yeah. You know, Christian was kind of starting to get hot, and he got hurt. You know, so with all the stuff that was, you could get very negative over, this crew doesn't. They just keep working hard, and they stay happy, and they stay focused, and they keep going. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm lucky for that. You know, very fortunate to have stepped into most of that. There's been a few changes since I came along, as far as personnel, but not a ton. And it's a great place to work. I mean, and then the whole company in large, you know, John Hines is awesome to work for. And he has a different look at it, even though he knows so much about the racing, his business approach to it and the way he can take like a racer mentality that we have and mm-hmm. kind of go, hey, we also need to look at it this way. I've learned so much from him, and he's always available to someone like me who, you know, give me advice or help me work through a tough situation or whatever. So I think the whole company, the atmosphere, I guess is what I'm getting at, is just, it's a nice place to be, a nice place to work. I'm just happy to be there.
Nice. Well, I think we're out of time, but dude, I mean, here's to a great 2024 with a full team.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
Riders will be off the injured reserve and back to action.
Yep.
And man, it's been a pleasure knowing you all this time. And it's funny the memories that we have of certain things.
Yeah, I'm sure we could go back and forth for a while, but yeah, appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
But yeah, thanks for coming on. Yeah. And we'll see you at the first playoff, right?
Here yes, coming soon.
Yeah. All right, guys, thanks for checking out the SML show. Please like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.